Hey, greetings, everybody. This is Srini Thunta from Detroit, Michigan. And we have a wonderful team here from RedisTalkIt.com and then IMLOS, including our attorney, Rajguru Nalaya, who does not need any introduction. So RedisTalkIt.com is about creating a well-informed community and an empowered community. We want to make sure that you get the best professional advice, and we do webinars typically every day from Tuesday through Friday on various topics, including work, whether it is technology or professional advice, and then life and motivation, and then youth webinars, exclusively youth interacting with the fellow youth, and it improves their public speaking skills. They have free sessions on Tuesdays and Wednesdays at 4 p.m. Eastern time, like every week, and then on the Friday they go live, and then we also have yoga classes on Wednesdays and Sundays. So it's all about building a an informed and empowered community, as I indicated earlier. Before we dive into today's session, just a couple of pointers at the very high level. All the latest information can be seen at any point of time at our website, letustalkit.com. Whether it is about next webinar, the time of the next webinar with Rajguru, you can find that there. And then also how to join the community groups that we have established, like we have established a WhatsApp group. You can join from there, and then Telegram group. But to mind you, these are set up for community interaction, and letustalkit.com or IMLOS are not responsible for any advice you receive from the community groups. If you want to really get the legal advice, in the right way, so always go to letustalkit.com/help. Where you can choose a category there, paid immigration attorney consulting. So that is the best way. And also, there could be some generic questions, where you may not really need an attorney appointment. So for those questions, you can always go to the same link, letustalkit.com/help, and choose the category, just immigration, and you can put your question. So far we received probably 120 plus questions there, and then our team is consolidating that information and then trying to provide this informative webinar right now, which is generic information and is useful for everybody. But when it comes to individual scenarios, we recommend that you really take an attorney appointment. That is the best way to go for. And also, if you are trying to decide, hey, do I really need an attorney? I think we communicated that WhatsApp group as well. Do I need attorney? I think if you are part of these Telegram groups or all the community WhatsApp groups, that link also was sent. Anyway, the simplest thing is, don't be confused. Just go to letustalk.com/help, and then put your questions there in the right category, and we will report on that. Okay, so I think we are ready for today's session. And also we uploaded the session number one's recording as well on, you can find it on Let Us Talk It YouTube channel, and also the recording was sent. And we are always open for feedback and to improve. And then we had a couple of appointments with Rajguru, the paid appointments last week. And we have been monitoring the feedback as well. On the quality of that, and then we have received excellent feedback. Some of you in this call may already have known that Rajguru is known to provide the best attention to detail and going into the depths of the legalities, so you can count on that. And also you have seen Murhari Devabatni, who has been patiently trying to help screen the initial questions and trying to provide your initial advice. We are definitely here to help the community, and if there are more people from you who want to volunteer on various things to help facilitate in the community interactions, feel free to get in touch with me. Of course, but the legal official advice, we should really go with any official attorney. And here we are definitely recommending Rajguru for that. Okay, so with that said, so Murhari, why don't you, okay, before even Hari starts, I think Rajguru, why don't you, you know, give any high level overview about the latest updates. And then after that, Murhari will dive into that, you know, big, gigantic Excel sheet of the questions, and he will ask from there.
Yeah, good. So we were discussing in the last two seminars, webinars. So we were talking about how we can file this 485 this season to open this opportunity, and also downgrading from EB3 to EB2, all those things. But I see that a lot of messages, WhatsApp messages, and you know, web posting by other attorneys too. They are some of them. They are kind of, you know, they are talking about what is the issues they are going to have when we are converting from EB2 to EB3, bona fide employment things, and even some people they are saying that USCIS may deny these EB3 petitions, kind of. So we wanted to discuss today all what are the risks involved in when we are downgrading to EB3 from EB2 petition, and what happens to that previous EB2 application, and any possibility of RFEs, you know. So anyhow, you know, all the cases, you know, when we have immigrant petition or non-immigrant petition, there are mostly we are receiving a request for evidence, and what kind of issues we can see in the request for evidence. And some of the employees, you know, applicants, they want to go back to the previous employer, and what risk they have when their previous employer filing EB3, whether they have ability to pay or not. Those things and all we wanted to discuss. Apart from that, we wanted to discuss about, as you said, whether applicants need an attorney, really they need an attorney or not. That point also we can cover it. And also basic reasons, sometimes, sometimes USCIS, they reject the 485 petition. Reject means, you know, before even resitting, before accepting, they can send it back. So there is a deficiency. For example, there is no signature in one place. There is no required form. For example, this time and all, if you do not put a form 944, they are going to reject it. If there is no 485J, they are going to reject it. And if there is no signature, the filing fees. So these kind of common issues also we can discuss it. As he said, you know, if they are applying on their own, it has to be a little careful this time. Previous years, you know, we have experience, many employees, they file 485 on their own. But this time, a lot of things changed. So we are not going to do the same way we did 3 years back or 4 years back. So many firms, they have included, excuse me. Sorry, I just traveled back from Dallas to Houston, so I have a little trouble. So also there is a filing fee change. So if, let's say, if you are looking at today, the USCIS filing fee, that is not good for filing after second, it can be denied. And some employees, you know, some applicants, they were asking whether they can use credit card form to file the petition. So that is true, the credit card going to help, because when we are looking at a lot of money, around 6,000, 7,000 on filing fee, you can use credit cards. But there is a small risk when you are using credit card. For some reason, if your credit card declined, so because there are six applications you are submitting, you have to submit a separate credit card form. So in case if that is declined, so your whole case is going to come back to you. So this is all the practical issues we are going to discuss today. So saying that, you know, Hari, you can lead this, then, you know, we can move on to the questions too.
Sure. Thank you for giving that summary. Welcome, everyone. I still see a lot of people still joining, but let's get started. We will start off with the initial agenda of the webinar that was sent out, and then we'll move on to the questions. The questions have been consolidated, so if you do not see a date asking, it's still valid for you. I'm not going to ask every single date. My PD is in September, October, and all those things. So the questions have been consolidated. We're covering most of them, but anything if we do not cover, we reach back to see what we can do towards the end of the session. So the first topic, Rajguruji, if you can talk about the risk involved in a downgrade, what is the possibilities of RFEs, and any known issues or reasons they might highlight that they should prepare before applying?
Yes. So here, if you see that there are who are downgrading, so there are two categories now. One is they are downgrading with the actual employer who filed I-140 previously under EB2, and they are continuing to work for them, and that employer now downgrading to EB2 to EB3, whatever, one category. The other one, some of the applicants, they are trying to request the previous employer whose EB2 petition already withdrawn, revoked, whatever, so they want to refile the EB3 to see the option whether they can file EB3 petition by using the same labor. So that means they are not working for the employer for last 2-3 years or 4 years, whatever, and now they are trying to see how they can get get filed, whatever, the two categories there. So out of this, what kind of RFEs we can receive, how we know what issues we are going to see, you know, when they are filing the petition. Here, you know, when it comes to immigrant petition, USCIS is going to look around the three main things. So one is ability to pay. And next one, whether the employee qualified for the position, that is educational wise and experience wise. So always they are going to look whether the employee has experience as required in the labor form, whether they have education, and the petitioner has ability to pay. Those three things come into picture. So RFEs, if it comes, everything, you know, it's going to be within these three things. And another one, the new issues recently, in the last 2-3 years, we are looking at whether the employer has a genuine offer to file the petition. It's called the bona fide employment RFE. That's what we call that, bona fide employment. Normally in the last few years, we are seeing that when there's a bona fide employment, we have to sometimes even USCIS ask for contract copies with a consulting company to client work orders, where he is currently working, all those things. And one more thing also they can ask. So let's say your employer initially when in 2012, 2013, when they are filing, probably they are in New Jersey in one county, and now they move to somewhere else. So if you are going to use the same labor to convert it, so whether you tested market in where they are currently, so which work location you are going to list in the EB3 petition. So whether you are going to list the old address or new address, if it's a new address, whether it is already covered in the labor certificate or not, most of the time we put unanticipated US location, every attorney they do. But if it is not, even if there is an unanticipated US location, so USCIS may send RFE. They send RFE whether we tested market in that area. So some employers, for example, let's say they moved from Detroit to Dallas. So Dallas to California, kind of those things and all, they're entirely moving to new geographical area. So whether that previous labor certificate is still good to go or not, this is all individually we have to evaluate, and how we can address, we have to discuss with the employer, and what kind of documents we have to provide. This is all you guys have to make sure everything it is good in line, all those aspects, you know, we are covering it or not. Then when it comes to education, let's say you have a EB2 approval in 2012, 2013, that time the processing standard was a little different, and now the processing standard a little different. Even we have approvals for EB2 with even 3-year degree with 1-year diploma or something. So without any RFE, sometimes, you know, after RFE, we submitted education evaluation, all those things, they approved. But now, if you have 3-year degree and your labor certificate requires bachelor degree as a minimum requirement, you may not get approval. So when you are not going to get approval in EB3, they may go back to EB2 because you are not qualified for that labor certificate, they can revoke EB2 also. So that every case you have to evaluate clearly. And when it comes to experience also, it has to be, you have to use maybe the same experience letter. And anyway, you cannot use any more experience after the labor date filing, because everything you have to establish before that labor certificate file. Those experience letters also, previously, you know, so some letters without even detailed job duties and all, USCIS used to approve, but now they want detailed experience letters. So you have to make sure whether you have such kind of experience letters. So then again, ability to pay, when it comes to ability to pay, RFE, we can get it. In the ability to pay means, let's say you left the company 3-4 years back, and now you are requesting them to file a petition, and you do not have a W-2 or, you know, pay statement. And the employer may have, you know, showing the net income in their tax return. Let's say they are showing 500K. So they can support 4 or 5 people. So, but 4 or 5 people also not like you. Maybe, you know, they have to support their current employees also. So in this case, let's say they have 10 cases to file, 5 of them working with them and 5 they are not working. If they are not able to establish ability to pay for the 5 people, probably USCIS is going to deny all the 10 cases. So they have to establish ability to pay all the cases they are filing, not just, you know, 5 cases they have ability to pay, 5 cases they don't have, kind of. So they have to establish ability to pay for all the petitions so that they have running with the risk that they can lose all the cases. So make sure whether the employer has ability to pay, they have to look at the net assets, look at the net income. Not only that, they are, you have to see how many applications they are filing, how many applications they are pending with USCIS at this time, and how many they are filing, whether they can support all the applications. Otherwise, the petition is going to be denied. Not only your petition, everybody's petition from that company will be denied. Maybe one case USCIS overlooking and approving it, one they don't approve it. So you have to really careful on that aspect also. So this is all the RFEs we can expect it. And also mainly the bona fide employment issue. So whether there is a genuine offer or not. So now, you know, there are bulk filing it's going to be, then definitely USCIS is going to presume that there is no valid offer. So you have to prepare for that request for evidence. If you are not going back and working for the employer, probably they cannot give a proper reason why they are reinstating the EB3, you know, once they withdrawn or canceled. Now why they are refiling it. So better if you are staying with one employer and requesting the other employer to file, may not be a good idea. Better you can go back to the employer. At least, you know, you can establish there is a bona fide employment offer available. And also, again, ability to pay, you have to look at it. So this is all the request for evidence. We can get it from the USCIS.
Thank you. You have covered few other topics too under the same thing. So the other thing is, during the downgrade, if an EB3 petition, downgrade petition is denied, how would that affect the existing EB2? You kind of said that in case if it's denied and they find out some fraud, then the EB2 one is also denied and it cannot.
Not only fraud, if you are not qualified for EB3, definitely you are not qualified for EB2 also. So it is all based on the reason why they are denying it. So if they say that there is no bona fide employment or education wise you are not qualified, they can go back to EB2 petition and they can send the intent to revoke. So in the same line, what issues you are going to have in EB3.
All right. So let's go to some of the questions that we have. You know, we answered some of them in our previous session, but they popped up again. From an overall timeline, in case for a downgrade and concurrent 485, are we able to tell what might be an expected timeline, meaning 3 months you would get EID, AP, and then 140 in like next 4 to 8 months, and 485 in a year? Any prediction?
At current situation, when you are filing 485 concurrently, EAD and parole, It's taking approximately around 4 months to 6 months. But anyhow, now the number of applications are very less. So when we are going to have this many applications, it may take longer. So we have similar situation in around 28. That time it took almost 8 months to 9 months to get EADs. So maybe you can expect maybe few applications when they are started processing, you can get it around 3-4 months time. And later it may go beyond 7-8 months to get an EAD.
Okay. I've never worked with the NIB, not many people, but surprisingly five people throw in questions for the NIB, the National Interest Waiver category.
Right.
So they have an approved EB2 to through that NIW category, National Interest Waiver. They're asking, can they downgrade it to EB3? It's a self-nominated, no employer.
Correct, yeah. So that National Interest Waiver, only they can do under that category, EB2 National Interest Waiver category. So they can put the priority date for EB3, but they need an employer. So EB3 petitions can be filed only by employer. You cannot file on your own. So let's say if there is an employer available, but anyhow, they have to go through the perm process, all those things. So it's going to take time. So they cannot do anything immediate.
You kind of covered the next question a little bit, but they're asking if we have to go back to the previous employer for the downgrade and for the ability to pay, it's better to work with them. So does that mean that they have to first apply a H-1, wait for it to get approved, then go, and then after that do it? Would be a good duration before they file a downgrade with the old employer.
I got the question. So in this case, so ability to pay, they have to understand it is not from now. If you join now, USC is not going to check only from the date you are rejoining. So they are going to check from the date labor certificate originally filed. That means sometime before 2015. So from that point, you know, they have to, let's say, you know, they worked until 2018 with that employer, they have W-2 payroll or whatever they can establish. And after 2018 to 2020, if they are not working, so they cannot establish anything unless the employer has the ability to pay from their income level. So if you are joining either today, after 1 month, it's not going to make any difference because still you are not showing ability to pay for around 2 years. And this 1 month, nothing big deal. So you don't need to do H-1B right away. So you can see, join with the employer may help on that bona fide employment reasons. But when it comes to ability to pay, still you have to show the ability to pay from the beginning, not just, you know, from now. So if you are joining after 15 days, 1 month also, it is fine. But, you know, anyhow, you have to prepare to show the ability to pay for the previous period you are not working. So you can include this 1 month also into that.
All right. The next question is, while filing for 485, what if the primary applicant is in US and the dependents are in India? Can the primary applicant still file as an adjustment of status and the dependents do a consulate process in the same application?
Yeah, so you cannot actually consulate process. It's totally different thing. What you have to do, if you are filing I-485 only for principal applicant, you can still file it. And for the dependents, whenever they are coming into US, they can file while your 485 is still pending. That is one option. And another one, something called follow to join. Follow to join means after getting your green card, if they are already qualified, that means they're already got married before 485 approval and they have children, you know, so they born before they are getting 485 approval, they can do something called follow to join in the consulate. So they no need to do anything in through the NVC process and all because they are derivative applicant. Once you file 485, you cannot do the consulate process way, but you can do follow to join is nothing but a consulate process only for a spouse and kids who got stuck in India. But they have to do only after you get green card. And another thing, if you see, if you notice in current bulletin, permanent resident, spouse, kids and all, it's almost current now. So there will be no delay. So even you after you get your green card, but you know what, when they are going to get green card after 4 years, 5 years, probably everybody going to get green card. With this situation, there will be a lot of people will be there. So, but follow to join, it's an option, it's there. So okay. Otherwise, you know, down the line, whenever you are 485 pending, if they are coming to US, that time, again, it has to be current. Then only you can file it, you know, at least the filing date or, you know, final action date, if it's available, they can file 485 in between.
Thank you. The next question is kind of a follow-up to the earlier question. So the primary applicant is still in US, the dependents are in India. Because of the COVID, they do not want to travel right now. But in May or June, they expect the COVID situation to go away and travel. So they're asking, and they don't know what the dates will look at that point. So can they still go ahead and do primary adjustment of status and then dependents as consulate? And then once they come to US, can they interfile it and then convert it into an adjustment of status?
Yeah, that's what I don't think principal applicant has to wait for them. They can go ahead and file their petition. So whenever the spouse, kids, they are coming to US, that time dates are okay, they can do it. But area of consulate process, you are not going to apt anything. After your green card approval, then you can do follow to join. That's the only way you can do consulate process. Or, you know, after getting your green card, you have to file family-based case, I-130, and they have to do whatever permanent residence or spouse category, whatever they have to do it. But at this time, they can go and file it. You know, they no need to wait for family to come. By the time, we don't know whether date's going to be available or not.
All right, thank you. The next question kind of is categorizing a lot of people into that, the birth certificate related question.
Yeah.
So they're asking, so some of them are missing their name. So wherever the name is supposed to be displayed, it's just displaying a blank right there. So there is no name. So they issued a birth certificate. The parents' names are there, but the kid name is not there. Some of them are missing the last name. Some of them only have one alphabet in their last name. Some of them are missing their parents' last name. So they're asking, some of them, their certificate is good. The wife's certificate is not good. And for some, the primary is not. So they're asking, what is the thumbnail to use the birth certificate? Does it have to be 100% accurate, or with 50% accurate and alternative documents, can we still use the birth certificate?
Yes, they can use such a birth certificate if there is a spelling error, or, you know, that name not abbreviated, no kind of things, parents' last name is missing. All those things, they can use that birth certificate along with a couple of affidavits clarifying all those things. So all we have to say that the person listed in the birth certificate and the current name, they are both are same. So we have some templates on those, you know, so they can write the affidavit, you know, so they can get the affidavit and submit along with that birth certificate. Only thing, when there is no birth, then you have to go for non-availability, and no birth certificate, then you have to go for non-availability certificate and then affidavits. But in such any deficiency in the, but if there is a date of birth is wrong, so don't use that. So if a name correction and all you can do, but instead of 1988, it says 89, you should not use it. So maybe you can work with the authorities to correct it, or you can go for a non-availability certificate from the authorities. Then along with that, affidavits will do.
Thank you. Yeah. On the same grounds, I think so. One of them has a tricky question, and I don't think anyone can really help except for the authorities, but I'll ask. They have a blank name on the birth certificate. The authorities are not willing to correct it. When they ask for a non-availability certificate and search it, it is still pulling up their birth certificate, which has a blank name on it. Yeah. So they are not ready to give an NR. So what do they do?
Okay, such you can use that blank birth certificate along with a couple of affidavit to your parents or, you know, elders who has knowledge during the time. So that means, you know, make sure you get affidavit somebody at least 15-20 years elder than to you. So they can give an affidavit. Yes, on this day, there is a male child born or female child born. I know their family, I'm family friend. They named the child, whatever that name. So kind of, they have to provide this affidavit. So along with that affidavit, couple of affidavit, UCS will accept it.
Okay. On the same affidavit question,
and also, not only affidavit, you can use any school records, like the transfer certificates, you know, so normally in school we used to have TC, right? TC, if it has a parent's name on it, you can use that. All old documents, anything. So like 10th certificates or, you know, any transfer certificate, college documents, it has to be a little closer to the birth. So this is all called secondary evidence. So affidavits and school certificates, those things and all secondary evidence, along with that birth certificate, you can use them.
On the same grounds, they're asking, can we use a copy of the birth certificate instead of original?
Yeah, you can use a copy. So in 485 process, you no need to submit anything original. All you are going to submit copies only. So even if somebody getting in India just now and they can scan it to you, you can print and you can submit it. So originals you may need during the interview process only. So if you are submitting any copies, make sure you have the originals with you.
Okay. Same birth certificate, couple of more, and just club these two. The affidavit, they took it in 2015 because at that point they had an opportunity, but then it closed too quick. So they took it. For some of them, the notary doesn't have an expiry date on it. So they are saying, can we reuse it? And for some of them, they are saying the notary had an expiry date on it. Can they still use the old affidavit from 2015?
Yes, you can use the old affidavit. The notary expiry date is only the notary's commission expiry date. So if that document was signed before that expiry date, it is definitely valid still. So you can use affidavits prepared in 2015.
Okay.
Yeah.
The next question, I don't know. So they're asking, there's a lot of confusion on the filing fees, the old filing fees, the new filing fees. Can we say, calculate and say, can you please mute whoever is that? Sorry, I was muted. Can you also unmute yourself? We have to mute all, Rajguru sir. You are also muted right now.
Looks like he got disconnected.
Yeah.
Yeah. So meanwhile, Hari, why don't you go ahead and tell any generic information?
Sure. So generic, some of them that were covered during the last one is, if the EB3 140 is approved, does that invalidate the EB2 140? Again, we said that's not the case. If your new 140 is approved, then you have both of your 140s valid. But again, as the other question was, if the EB3 is denied, will it affect the old already approved? There is a good possibility, as Rajguru sir just mentioned, in case that firm did not pass the EB3 ability to pay test, then there is a good chance that they overlooked it and they approved it during the EB2 process. So they can revisit and can also deny the old petition that was approved by an oversight. couple of people asking their priority dates is actually, they have a priority date of EB2, which is in between September 2009 and May 2011. Does it still make sense to downgrade it to EB3 and then file the 485, because they are already eligible to file 485 at this point of time? So if you are eligible to already filing a 485 at this point of time in EB2, there I don't see a real reason why you should be downgrading it. The question a couple of people asked is, how come EB3 is advanced to 2010 on the final action date and EB2 is still in 2009? And if the spillover is first coming to, I'll just finish that sentence, or I can put the same question to Rajguru sir. He's here.
He's back. Yeah.
I'm sorry. Yeah.
So, yeah, couple of people. I was just about to answer one or two questions, but since you're here, I can put it to you, and we can go back to the birth certificate. Yes. So they're asking, how come since spillover first applies to EB2? How come EB3 date is even advanced than EB2?
This is all based on the number of EB2 petitions they approved so far are pending. So maybe there are more subscribers towards EB2 and EB3 is less. So that is the only reason. So now we are filing too many EB3 petitions now. And EB2 also, they are not going to revoke or cancel. So they are going to count that number also. So now, since you are filing EB3 and you already have an EB2, so both the dates, it's going to be backward. So because you are filing EB3, they are not going to remove you from EB2. So that I-140 also approved. So this is all based on the number of applications filed and number of applications approved and the green cards not approved yet. So since EB2 is more people, filed it. So that's how EB3 is going forward. So in fact, they need more, they have more visa numbers for EB3 than EB2.
All right. So the next question is, who qualifies for an expedited 485? Why does it say that it's a case by case situation? What would be a good criteria to say that my application qualifies for an expedited 485?
Expedited 485, if you ask me, for all our employment-based category, probably they are not going to work on it unless there is a national interest involved, kind of. But for our kind of cases and all, it is a very, very rare chance. I don't think it's a... I can say that we have a less than 1% chance they can accept that.
Okay. The next question is on the medical. What would be a good time to take medical? Even if we take medicals today and the 485 is pending for more than 2 years, if we have to resubmit medicals, what is the point of taking medicals today?
That is right. If you are not submitting now, you can wait until you get a request for evidence to submit it. So you don't need to submit after 2 years, 3 years while the petition is pending in between. So even if you get an interview, that time also you can take a medical certificate with you. So, but until you have a request for evidence on that or you have an interview notice, you don't need to do it.
And the next question, I think so a lot of people put it in different ways, but they're asking if the company does not want to support, and it has a follow-up question down, but the primary, I'll just club, not able to support the 140 or 485, can we go ahead and apply ourselves? We can pay for it.
Okay, definitely you cannot do anything on I-140. I-140 is petitioner's, employer's petition. So they must sign the petition. They have to file it. Let's say you want to downgrade from EB2 to EB3. If they are not filing that petition, so you can't do anything. So when it comes to 485, So now the previous years and all, we need a letter from the employer to a job confirmation letter to file along with 485. So all you need I-140 and one letter and 485. But those years when, but currently there's a change, you know, instead of letter, now we are going to use form 485J. The previous years, if there is no letter, still USCIS accept that 485. But now without 485, they are not going to accept you, without 485J, they are not going to accept your 485 petition. So the 485J has to be signed by that employer. That's nothing but they are reconfirming the offer and they are certifying that they are still good to go, kind of, still they have the offer. So if that employer is not giving, so you cannot sign it. So, but I recently, I heard that one attorney in Houston, he's actually, that advice is not correct. They should not do it. What he's trying to do, he's trying to file I-485 by using 485J of the current employer who were. So in fact, I know that there's a INA 204J, it says that to use portability, you must wait 180 days after filing 485. But this attorney trying to just use the current employer's 485 and let that 485 accepted, because you need some 485 in that. The time of numbering, they are not going to look at it, whose 485J it is or whatever. But there is a process called 485J approval. During that time, they can notice that it is not from the original employer, they can deny it. But I don't know why that attorney advising that, but that is not a good way to do it. So you need 485J from that I-140 petitioner. So that's how, you know, you can file 485. So if they are not supporting, you have very limited to do anything in this process.
Sure. The next question again kind of was there on the previous list too, is they have to, the wife works for a different company, the husband works for a different company, they both have approved 140s. Should they both downgrade and file for 485, or should only one of them downgrade and file for 485?
I would suggest one of them downgrade to EB3 and the other one, they can keep that EB2 option. So whenever the dates are going backwards and, you know, EB2 comes, you know, you can use your spouse's EB2 petition to interfile. So that I would suggest to go at least only one to downgrade to EB3, but not the other spouse.
Okay. The next question is on the perm certification. On the original perm, the minimum requirement was put in as master's. They did not say bachelor's qualifies or bachelor's plus 5 years qualify or anything. Can we still use the original perm when it says the minimum requirement is master's for an EB3 downgrade?
Yes, we can use it. So simple answer is yes, we can use it, but the master's still the master's requirements still qualify for EB3, because for EB3, the minimum requirement is only, you know, so either 2 years experience or a bachelor degree, but here you have a master's requirement. So that petition still qualified for EB3.
Okay.
Yeah. Let's say so if you have a labor certificate, it needs only high school. So without any experience requirement, that is not qualified for EB2.
So the next question
EB3.
Is
I'm sorry, it's not qualified for EB3.
All right. The next question is, in the past, we used to submit a W-2 with 485. Why are they asking tax returns now? Mm-hmm. And also in the form I-944, why are they asking for a credit report? Does my home mortgage affect it? Because my credit report shows that my debt is a lot more high because of my home mortgage. Some of them included, I have a bad score because I kind of missed few payments. Will they look at my score? Will that impact it? Will they look at my credit payment history? So some light on the overall two aspects. One, why do they need tax returns? Why can't the W-2 do it? And then the other one, why are they asking credit report and debt statement, and will the home mortgage affect it?
Yeah, so that the main reason is that public benefit charges, like they don't want it to be a burden to government. So, you know, that recently there was a rule on public charge. So just they want to see that whether you have enough financial ability to support yourself without burdening government in the future. But mainly these things, they enacted the rule for family-based cases who were coming in. But unfortunately, we have to also answer all these questions. But as long as as long as you have not received any public benefits previously, but that means there are public benefits means there are 7-8 acts. It's also listed in the same form. Based on that, whether you received any funds from the government, even California has some household rental assistance or whatever. So such kind of public benefits, if you received, so they are not going to treat you that you are free from public charge or whatever. If you see that in public charge rules also, we have to look at it in very detail. But most of our employment-based cases, they never received a public benefit. So you will be fine with that. So if public benefit also, if you received only 1 month, it's not going to trouble you. If you received continuously in the last 36 months for more than 12 months, then only it is going to be, there's an impact in your application. So previously, as you said, you know, they collect only W-2, whatever tax returns, sometimes they ask. But because of the public charge rule, now they want credit reports and credit history, credit scores, tax returns, bank statements to show your assets, mortgage and all. But even if you are providing all this, I'm not expecting any difficulty in getting green card, because most of our employment-based cases, we have enough income, so we are not going to be a public charge at all. And when you are looking at the credit reports, main problem I'm looking at, so you have to cross-check the employer's names in your credit reports. So some of them, they have that employees, they never worked. So you have to make sure, go through the reports and see that how it is. You know, so during the 485 process, if they look at that, you work for somebody else. For example, let's say you are working for a consulting company, but you work for one client. So instead of your employer's name, you somehow by mistake, you listed client name. So that client name showing up in the credit report. So this may be a problem. During interview, they can question, oh, your credit report says that your employer is, for example, Walgreens or something. So you have to carefully review it and make sure whether you can correct it by connecting with the agency. I don't think it's very quick you can do it. So such cases and all, bring to your attorney's notice, and you know they can see that how they can address that. Apart from that, the tax returns, I believe you can submit only one tax return, the last year tax return, and W-2 also you can submit it. And main thing is for kids, when it comes to kids also, they are asking credit reports. So if you cannot get a credit report, all you have to apply for it, and you have to take a screenshot or printouts saying that, you know, it is not available. So credit reports main thing, bank statements, whatever, you know. So, but I don't think it's going to impact anyway, you know, getting green cards, unless you are filing a bankruptcy or otherwise you have no salary or whatever, then only it's going to be a problem.
Okay. The next question is again on the date movement. They're asking, do we, since we are expecting rapid forward movement, what can we expect in the month of November? Do we have any predictions? I think so that's going to be hard, but I'll just let you comment.
For November, we don't have any prediction. Probably it's going to continue this thing. Probably we can see some improvement in EB2 for November. But anyhow, since we cannot predict it, so better we can wait until October 15th, that 18th time. If dates are dates are going to continue, then you have enough time to file your 485 even in the next month. So we have to wait and see one.
So the next question is, they're saying that their H1 is extension is pending based on the EB2 140. Mm-hmm. Now, during the downgrade, what if the EB3 140 is denied and subsequently the EB2 140 is also denied? What happens to the H1B extension?
So, You are claiming that what if EB3 denied and subsequently EB2 denied, right?
Yes. Yeah. And the extension is based on EB2 140.
Correct. Yeah. So that USCIS, when going to look at the H1B qualification for extension beyond 6 years, they are going to see that at the date of filing of your H1B petition, whether you are qualified for that benefit or not. So in these cases, let's say if you already applied a petition for extension and it is pending, as of the date of application, whether you had approved I-140 or whether you your labor certificate valid for filed for before 365 days still pending, or what, that's what they're going to look at it. If you already filed it, even if that petition is denied later, you are good to go. But for the next extension, it would be a problem. So next extension, why they are if they have that EB2, if they are revoking it, previous EB2, if they revoke for fraud, misrepresentation purpose, you cannot use it. If employer withdrawn, you can still use it. So if your extension is currently pending, they are going to look at it at the date of filing, whether you were qualified or not.
Okay. Now, I'm not sure if we answered. They're asking how much is it for a family of four to file 485. Did we already answer that?
I don't think so. So now, if you are family of four, how much it is going to cost to file 485? After October 2nd, there is no difference in the fees for kids or adults. So both are same. It is going to be $1,130. And they have $30 fingerprint fee. Fingerprint fee, it's not applicable for kids, but normally we don't want to take chance to get it rejected. So just we put that check. If USCIS take that check, it's okay. If they return it, also fine. So we used to include a fingerprint for kids also. So you can calculate now $1,130 four times and $30 for fingerprint. And apart from that, you guys have now EAD, parole, all those things. Normally, we don't file EAD for kids. So if they are close to 18 years or 15 years, maybe you can file it to get SSN and all. But if they are younger, you don't need to file EAD. But normally, we file advance parole. But advance parole also, it is not required if you are traveling on H-1B status or L-1 status. So if you want to avoid that cost, if you are on H-1B, L-1, so you don't need to spend that money. Or otherwise, you don't need to file those right now. But whenever you need that time, you can submit it. But again, you have to see the processing time. Maybe it's going to take 6 months or whatever. So once you have the 485 receipt in hand, at any time you can apply parole and EADs. So this all, you have to plan it. I know that this time it's going to be really expensive. So you can plan it and you can file your EAD 485 and a little later after getting receipts also.
And the new fee for AP and EAD is 550 and 590, right?
Correct. Or, yeah. Yes.
All right. So that kind of summarizes most. One more question, kind of put it in the other category. So they're asking, they have an double CPT, so they are doing the day one CPT. So while doing the 485, they would look for your stay in US is legal or not. Would the double master's day one CPT cost have any issues during the 485?
Yeah, that, you know, if you frankly asking, we have not experienced that in 485 process. So there was a rule in between, and it was stayed, and it's not out yet. That according to that rules, you know, they were determining all these kind of people, you know, they are not maintaining status. So if that court order comes later, you know, so if they are going to, you know, that a lot of university they were suing, and that rule was stayed now. If that rule comes back, and there may be some problem in 485, because all the time from the date they are entering into US, they have to maintain status. If there is anything beyond 180 days, it's going to be a problem in 485. So, but any of this F1 CPT things and all, it never experienced in 485 process at this time. So, because we never filed for these people 485, because it's not current at all for several years. So we have to wait and see. So, in my view, as long as their F1 status was valid and OPT was valid, whatever legally, maybe it's not a problem. But even in H1B nowadays, say we are seeing that if they took practical training more than 12 months, they are claiming that you are not maintaining status kind of. So these things and all, we have to wait and see only. So we are not sure how USC is going to process such cases.
All right. The next question, I think so. They should look for a personal consultation. Whoever that is, can you please mute? The next question, I think so. They should look for a personal consultation, but I'll just throw in, maybe you can give a one liner or two liner. They have their H1 is valid till 21, November 2021. The I-94 that came with the H-1 is valid till June of 2021. But now during the downgrade, they went online and they saw on the DHS.org the I-94, and it says that it expired on June 2020, which they did not even know about. So they're asking, what do we do, and why, how come they gave a H-1 approval for a longer duration? The I-94 attached with it has a different duration, and the online DHS has a different duration, and they haven't yet checked it till now. And what is their course of action? What do they have to do? Because they're already, according to online, they are out of status for like 3 months now.
Right. So in this case, that H-1B approval, if it has one validity period in the employment validity period, and if it has I-94 less period, so probably that is a mistake. They could have corrected that time itself. So, and another thing, it is not clear whether they traveled after this approval or before this approval. If they traveled after this.
I asked the clarification. They said they did not travel from the previous system.
So they have not traveled after that approval. Okay, yes. So then now they can go for, if they have not traveled that online I-94, it is always going to show the one when they are entering into US. So because even when you are putting the passport number, whatever, let's say they entered it sometime 2017, that is the I-94 it is going to show until now. So it is not going to reflect any USCIS approval in the online status. So if they have, after they entered into US, if they applied for extension or whatever, only they have to look at the approval notice. If approval notice they have until November 2021, but I-94 has June 2021. That's what you mentioned, right? So
yes.
That means that I-94 currently is still valid. So, and another thing, they can look at that, whether that I-94 number and also whatever they are looking at the online I-94 number, whether they are same. So when we are applied, because they applied extension of that online I-94 and now they got approval. So that anyhow, you know, they have a June 2021 means, so they can still file an extension before June 2021, even though that validity period says November 2021. They don't need to wait until November, but in June itself, they can file an extension so that, you know, they will be good. Or otherwise, they can connect, their attorney can connect with the USCIS and figure it out why that I-94 issued a little shorter. So, but anyhow, you know, if you ask me, I would file in this case extension before June 2021, and we can get it extended.
Okay. The next question is that their H1 was denied a few months back. They had to move to India. They had a 140. They are still working with the same client, same employer, but they don't have H1, so they are getting paid in India. So they're working remotely for the same employer. So can we do a downgrade and apply while we are totally in India?
They can do that. You know, while they are in India, they can downgrade, they can apply, but they cannot apply for 485 because they are in India. So EB3, they can downgrade it, and same time he can work on H1B getting approval and going for stamping and come back. While he's coming back, still dates are available, then they can file 485. But applying EB3 petition, there is no restriction while he's in India also, he can file it. But again, employer's ability to pay will be a question.
Well, if they're in India and if it gets approved, or they can still do the consulate process, right?
They can do consulate process, but again, it's a NVC process, all those things. But that NVC process and all, it's going to be, there is no use. You know, it is all going to be based on the final action dates, not based on the filing dates. So filing dates, they have established to file 485 so that we are going to get some benefit out of it, but EAD and all. Consulate process, then again, you know, paper goes to NVC and they will work only if the dates final action available, then only they will call for interview.
Okay. Yeah, so the rest of, so I know every question I've not asked, and again, a lot of questions are repetitive questions in that list, and they're just talking about the priority rate. Yeah.
Hari Garu, a couple more generic questions probably we can ask and then close it. One of them is like, especially many were asking this, so when they're all planning to apply next month, and how long it is going to take for getting 485 approval or the EAD and the advanced parole. I know this is not easy to guess or something, but they just want your opinion on that, Rajguruji. And also, what happens if we have issues in the medical?
Yeah, medical issues normally, for example, let's say they have a TB kind of things.
So, TB, yeah.
Yeah, such kind of things and all, they will, they are not going to deny the person. Maybe the doctors also, they are going to suggest to take medication. Once they have taken that proper medicine and all, they are going to clear it. They are going to see the x-rays and all, they will clear it. So whatever the doctor they are working with for medical exams, or you know, if they are not doing any medical, let them go for a TB. If they suspect that they have TB, they can go for, you know, doctor's advice and take medications and all, have the certificates ready. Yeah, so if the TB, if they are taking that medication and the x-ray, if it's cleared, so there will be no issue in getting green card.
Yeah, the other question was like, how long the whole process is going to take, especially to get I-485 approval with the current load and all, you know?
Yeah, that we cannot tell that. It might take another, you know, so definitely it's not, in my view, it's not within next 5 years, unless that, you know, that recent days we are talking about, they are going to remove per country quota. And the family based numbers, they are going to put it in employment base. If such a miracle happens, we can get it quicker.
Okay. I missed out one of the questions is, while applying for 485, their kids are still under 21. What if the 485 takes few years for approval? Will the kids still get a green card?
Yeah, there's called the Child Status Protection Act. But Child Status Protection Act, it is applicable only for final action dates, not because you filed 485 based on the filing chart, they are not going to get protected. So the final action dates, you know, it's not current, and they already crossed 21, they may have, probably they are going to deny the green card for the kids. So this is another case, they have to case by case work with the attorney to see that really they can continue on 485, otherwise they have to switch to their own status when they are going to get the 21 years, that they have to work with the attorneys. Again, Status Protection Act applicable only for final action dates if it's current, not who are filing in EB3 at this time, 485, probably they are not going to protect their childs.
Okay. Now it says that they will deduct their actual age with the pending period. Is the pending period pending 140 or pending 485?
Pending 140.
Pending 140.
Yeah, so nowadays, you know, people are filing in premium process. Again, you know, they're not going to take much advantage out of it.
Okay. Oh, so is the 140 took 6 months to file, they're just going to deduct that 6 months?
Yeah, see, if 140 after the filing date, if their 140 was pending to get approval 6 months or whatever, the 1 year, they can add that 1 year period to the child's age. That means they are going to deduct it. That means in 21, it's going to be 22 or whatever.
Gotcha. So that kind of concludes the overall questions being summarized. I see a lot of people have raised their hands, but I think so we kind of said, please put in your questions into the list so that we can consolidate and we don't have a lot of repetitive questions. Rajguru sir, I don't know how your time is. Should we?
Maybe we can take another 10-15 minutes. I'm fine.
Yeah, I have another. Okay. I have another update, Hari. I sent you the latest list of the questions. Did you see the latest download? Yeah. Meanwhile, you can look into that because there are some questions posted in the last 1 hour as well.
Okay. No, I did not. I took it from, I think, so whatever you sent earlier, right? That's what I considered.
Yeah, I posted just now. Yeah.
So the latest one, is that still a consolidation of all or just the delta of the new
one? It's a grand consolidation of everything together, always.
Okay.
The whole big list. Yeah, why don't you open that and go through that? Meanwhile, yeah, Rajguru, you can continue the general updates.
So, yeah. So one thing, they are asking a general question. What do you think of this whole thing, H4 EID? Should we depend more on H4 EID or should we go to 485 and start using the 485 EID?
Yeah, the H4 EID is still in the trial. So we don't know what's going to happen in that too. So if courts comes back and deliver order, we are going to lose that. But we don't know the timeline when it could happen. Maybe it can be confirmed also. So there is no certainty in it.
Okay. The other question they ask is who's responsible for filing the fee for the 485?
Mm-hmm. 485 is applicant. Applicant is the beneficiaries. There is there's no rule that the employer has to pay or whatever. So, but as an applicant, employer can say that you have to pay for it. So we cannot force them to pay if they're not paying it. But when it comes to labor certificate process, I-140 and all, petitioner, that means the employer is the petitioner. So maybe you can request them to pay. But when we are going to put a check from you for 140, still they will accept it. But this all between you and your employer, you can work it out.
Yeah. The next question, I think so the question is really not clear when they say if we have two green card applications running concurrently, both in EB2 with different employers, mm-hmm. one of them is downgraded to EB3 and denied, can the EB2 application of the second employer be used? So I don't get their situation. So they're saying that both two different employers have applied for their 140 and they both are concurrently right now doing. Can they, without getting the approval, are they asking, can we downgrade the other one and then use it?
Yes, actually, I believe that question he's asking if one petition is denied, the other one, whether they can use it or not, I believe. So the whatever, if you have an approved I-140, you can use it. So whether then we have to see that whether it's EB2 or EB3 dates are current or whatever, whether you can use it with the current pending 485 or whether you're going to file the petition and all. As long as you have an approved I-140s, it can be usable.
Yeah. One of the other question, I think so we already answered. One, so saying that the employer moved from New Jersey to Texas, can they still do premium process? I think so we already said premium by itself has complications, and now because of COVID and the perm certification process change, it's not recommended for anyone to do premium. They can do it at a later time in case it gets approved. But since they added the New Jersey to Texas, I'll let you comment any final comments on that.
So the question is, they have already approved from Nebraska and now they want to file downgrade in Texas. That's what they're asking, right?
Yeah, in premium.
In premium. Actually, you know, so one thing, if you are filing your I-140 concurrently with 485, you cannot do premium process at the first place. So let's say if you are filing a premium process, asking the USCIS to get a copy from another petition, even it is with that Nebraska Service Center or the same center if you are applying, they are not going to accept it. So that is what my experience in the last several years. If we are saying that a labor certificate is in other file, go ahead and get it to process my case, they are not going to accept it. There are four checkboxes in I-140 form. If you are checking that checkboxes, they are not going to accept. Yes, to those checkboxes, they are not going to accept under premium process. Always they return it. So only thing, you know, we see the situation after 3 months, 4 months, whether they are pulling that ETA 90 from one file to another file already moved, then, you know, they can upgrade to premium. So when you are downgrading premium as of now, it is impossible. Even today, we are filing one petition. We are downgrading to EB2 to EB3. The main EB2 filed in Texas Service Center. So I am mailing a case under premium process just to test it whether they are accepting or not. So I can give an update in next 2-3 days on that. So how USCIS is treating that? Because that EBT approved in Texas Service Center and we are filing the EB3 petition, Texas Service Center. Today we are mailing, tomorrow it will be delivered. Then I can, you know, get an update in another 3-4 days how they are treating it. But the previously I have experience, they never accept it.
Okay.
So the premium process is going to be, I believe in my view, 99% they are not going to accept it. But still a lot of people talking about it. We are trying one petition today.
Okay. So the next question is it good? So they are not qualified even if they downgrade it. But since there is a rapid movement prediction, they're saying for 2016 and 2017 people, should we just have the 140 downgrade application right now processed and ready so that if the dates move, they can file the 485?
You can do that. There are a lot of ways to do it. Somebody was asking yesterday, why we cannot have both EB2, EB3 perm filed and get one petition under EB3, one petition in EB2 with the same employer. So whenever the dates moves, they can use whatever they want. Yes, they can do it. So you can have separate EB3, separate EB2. If you have already EB2, don't disturb that. Don't just use that labor certificate to downgrade or whatever. Since you have enough time, go ahead, file a perm application and get EB3 approval now. So anyhow, you are going to put the dates. So if dates moves, you can use this approval to file it in down the line in 6 months or 1 year or whatever. So many employers, they have advertisement ready. If your employer has advertisement ready, let them file it.
The next question they're asking is, I have master's and bachelor's. Now that we are doing EB3, should I just ask the attorney not to include the master's and just put bachelor's in this
application? No, that is not a question at all. So they can include master's. There is no issues in getting EB3. It is not going to disqualify you because you have a master's to get in EB3. So even if they have master's requirement in labor certificate, still you can file under EB3. If you can get EB2, you can get EB3 definitely.
Okay. So the next question on the birth certificate, they're asking the birth certificate was registered later, not during the birth time. So let me answer. I think so. It's 2 years after birth, you got to register it, but they're asking, is it 1 year or 2 years after birth is what is acceptable? And alternative document, can I just use 10th certificate without an affidavit?
Yeah, you can use a 10th certificate. That is the secondary evidence. And if you are still getting a request for evidence, I would suggest, you know, to include affidavits also.
And is it 1 year after birth or 2 years after birth?
Actually, there is no standard on it. So if it is a reasonable time, they are going to accept, but they didn't spell it out whether it is a 1 year or 2 year or whatever the rules. So.
Yeah, they're saying their company, previous company is asking ability to, they can't prove ability to pay. If they join their company, then they will be able to show ability to pay. Mm-hmm. So can I just join them immediately? And then, so they, we kind of covered the same question earlier.
Yeah, again,
or should
actually, because they are going to join just now, they cannot establish ability to pay if they cannot establish for the period they have not worked earlier. So it's not just, they should not trick them to join to them right now. And again, they are going to get into that ability to pay issue if they have not worked previously for, let's say if you left the company 3 months back, 4 months back, maybe, you know, you can go back and, you know, we can establish ability to pay. Even last year, W2, if you have enough, then this year, if you don't have payroll with them, going back may help. But if you're not worked for 3-4 years and if you're just joining, it's not going to help. Unless they have the ability to pay, because this employer mentioned that they don't have ability to pay means you cannot establish for the period you are not working. So again, joining with the employer will help that whether there is a genuine offer, bona fide employment, whatever, that issues it can address.
Okay. Not sure what happened, maybe on my end, but can't see anyone.
Yeah, can you hear? Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, I can hear you.
Okay.
So
okay, I think so Hari, if you're done with the question digest, I think you looked at the latest one, right?
I looked at the latest one. There are a few more, but they are again, most of them either moving from one location to other location, which we kind of covered, irrespective of the employer moving or the employee moving. They're moving centers different. Can they still do it in downgrade? Yes, you can do downgrade. No premium allowed. I think so. We answered that. Dependent child aging out 21, we addressed that question. There's the Child Status Protection Act that would basically protect them up to a certain thing, but that is purely for employee-based category, purely based on final action date and not based on the filing date.
Okay, then I want to also remind the community that there are two ways that you can get advice. Number one, if it's a very generic question, you can post the question at letustalkit.com/help and choose the category immigration. But if you think it requires an attorney's attention and you know, you want to be 100% sure and secure, then choose the category at the same help link. Choose the category paid immigration attorney consulting, and you know, we will revert back to you with all the information and available slots of Rajguru. And yeah, definitely. So this is to help, you know, the community, feel free to spread the word. We have provided on the website has all the latest information. You always keep looking at the website. You can join the WhatsApp groups from there, and you can join the Telegram group from there, and you can access the help desk, and everything is right there. Question for Rajguru. So are we going to have this webinar session again?
Do you think you want to have a Wednesday or Thursday?
Yeah, Wednesday, maybe.
Wednesday, right? Okay, sure. Wednesday, I will update the timing because I have one more webinar on Wednesday schedule. So I will figure it out what time it is, then we can move on.
Yeah, also request if there are any other updates that require real-time attention, if you can provide a video bite or something, then we can broadcast it in all the WhatsApp groups.
Yes, sir, we can do that. Only the timing now, since we are a little busy now, it's going on, but I will pull something.
Yeah, sounds good.
Yeah.
Okay, so I think, we'll conclude the session for now. Actually, I wanted to tell another important piece of information. Yeah, there are many who were like in a limbo. Do I need to ask the attorney it's not needed. I mean, do I need an attorney consultation? So for that, we have set up a information call at 3 p.m. EST today, which is the same Zoom link. And Murahari, would be pre-screening and would be giving quick information whether you would really need attorney or not. And then whoever, needs attorney advice, then Murahari would be directing them to Rajguru.
So just a clarification, I wouldn't say whether they need an attorney or not. Anytime the information coming from an attorney is more, they're doing this full time, or more accurate information. I can give what information I know, what is out there. And if I don't know, I have to revert to the attorney. And it's always a good
another
advice.
Hari is talking to you or answering, it is in general nature. So you should not take that as a legal advice, because area, we are not authorized to provide legal advice. Only it is reserved to attorneys like me. So any information coming from Hari or general in postings, it is not legal advice. You cannot take that forward, whatever. You must consult with the attorneys if you really have concern on that.
Yeah, definitely. No, that's very important. The 3 p.m. call, really, Hari.
Do you need an attorney or not? That is maybe there are they are questioning to file their 485 or, EB3 to EB2 to EB3, whether they need an attorney to file it or not. In this one, mostly, that's what in my experience, 485, some people, they file on their own. So they think that why we have to spend this much money to attorneys, whatever. They can prepare 485, whatever. But this year, too many changes. So even some of them, it's new to us. So including filing fee change, how much file fees we have to put. So when I'm sharing the new fees to the applicant, they're coming back, oh, you are wrong. So then I have to tell them, oh, I'm not wrong. This is applicable after second. So they are looking at the USCSI. Let's say you are doing on your own, and based on the USCSI, if you put 1140 and submitting petition, it is going to be rejected. And when it comes to 944, you have to be really careful what to fill, what you should not fill it. And 485J, it's almost like I-140 form. So you need a lot of details to put in there, so that you have to do it. So when it comes to I-140 petition, mostly it's an employer's petitioner, always they use attorneys. So when there is an EB2 to EB3 petition, obviously you have to go with attorney.
Sure. I'll add my two lines to that is, I know people are talking about 485, whether they can do it or not. I would say either an attorney or an paralegal who's at least doing this for a long time, they should do it.
You know what? I don't recommend that. So I don't recommend that. The paralegal cannot give legal advice. So I never recommend that.
Okay.
Yeah. So, and also,
I was going to say that one thing you do mistake and then your 485 file is returned, and then the dates move and you don't have the window to apply again.
Yes.
That's going to put you in trouble. So, spending that extra money is definitely worth it, peace of mind, at least in case if it's returned or other things, the attorney can at least request the old postal date and can still see if they can accept it. It's up to USCIS whether they accept it or not, but it will be much more genuine and easier if it comes from the attorney.
Yeah, so just to add to that, so at the 3 p.m. call, our expectation is not that Hari should clarify your questions. Hari, what I would request to you is just to look at the complexity level. Okay, so yeah, this is, you know, this has, you know, specific scenario. So it is better to consult attorney. And then they can decide if they want to go with their own attorney or, you know, our recommended attorney, Rajguru.
Sure. Also, so the 3 p.m. call, what we can basically do is, a lot of people have generic questions that they put in and we clubbed in. We can take the questions from them and answer them. If it's generic, kind of pointed to that. Any generic information, we can give them the information. It's not going to be whether to go with an attorney or not. I think so. We already established that an attorney is required and it's definitely going to be helpful. There might be many cases wherein people might not use and still get one, but the recommended advice is always to go with an attorney so that you get whatever information you get is more authentic. We could answer any generic questions people have on anything or can pass on the information that the attorney has already kind of clarified in this and people were not able to join it and they want a further clarification. We could just reiterate what was said earlier or give out any generic information.
Yeah, so that's true. So I think that's a good, you know, whatever Rajguru already provided the information, you know, if some are not able to decipher it, it is better that, you know, you can provide the same information and, you know, clarify that. But yeah, so we do not want to take any chances and also we do not want to take any, get into any legalities where, yeah, attorney is, you know, is always a must in our opinion, whether it is, it could be your own attorney. You know, if you need, you know, help, yeah, we are always here to help with Rajguru's team. And yeah, all these attorney appointments are one-to-one directly with Rajguru. It is not with anybody else from Rajguru's office. It is with Rajguru. And then as we indicated earlier, based on the volume of the request, we really negotiated a very, very low price with Rajguru. We really thank him again for that. Is $150 per case. And then again, this amount will be adjusted if you are going ahead with, you know, IMLA's office. So that's the information. So yeah, so at 3 p.m., you can feel free to join. But yeah, it is more about the information that already Rajguru has provided. You know, that's how the, you know, meeting will be. Okay, so thank you all, everybody. And we'll provide the recording of this pretty soon. And yeah, feel, you know, always use the letustalkit.com/help. And yeah, feel free to subscribe to Let Us Talk It YouTube channel and also on the Facebook so that you can get all the updates real time. And as indicated earlier, we also provide other information, you know, and for example, for the, you know, startups and, you know, technology topics, webinars, you know, we do almost like every day there will be one webinar, including youth on Friday, and then public speaking skills for youth. It's a free training on Tuesdays and Wednesdays. And then we have yoga classes, which are Wednesdays and Sundays. Okay, thank you all. You have a wonderful one. And let us build this, you know, informed and empowered community together. Yeah, feel free to join hands. And if you can volunteer, always get in touch with us. There's a lot of work to be done on earth. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you all.
All right. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you all.
people don't realize the value of something until they've lost it. Because it's like digging a well after you're thirsty. When something means expansion, when something means happiness and harmony, we find ourselves automatically gravitating towards that. And since yoga does give you those results, why not give it a shot? Okay, so the question is that if I invest my time into yoga, how will I get it back? So yoga basically helps us achieve our optimal levels of physical, mental, emotional well-being. So when the hand, the head, and the heart are coordinated, everything that I do yields good, fast results. So I get to save more time. I get to do many more things very well, rather than the same set of things over and over again because I'm not able to handle them properly.